Let us pray. Lord, sanctify us through your truth. Your word is truth. Amen. Dearly beloved, brought into the flock of Jesus Christ, grace and peace to you. What are we to make of the church? The church which Jesus Christ purchased with his own blood. The church which he desires to be one. And yet, which seems so scattered, so fragmented, so weak, and so lost. Has she been abandoned? Why is she so divided? These are questions many people ask, and they are intensely personal questions for us because we are members of that church. And our allegiance to the church is really the only allegiance we have that matters. We have no nation. We have no race. We have no tribe. We are Christians. Our text is also a very personal text, as our gospel reading was also. Both of them show us the same thing. They show us the church and Jesus Christ, the head, the shepherd of the church, standing in the midst of her. They show us that our God is passionately protective of his sheep and that he comes personally to feed them in body and in soul. You know, you should never get between a mother bear and her cubs. She senses that you are going to harm her children. She will rip you apart. Remember, shortly after we started dating, Rachel used that metaphor to describe her mother's love for her and her sisters. And God's doing much the same in our text. So he doesn't talk about bears and cubs, but this image of the shepherd and the sheep is the same thing. He says, "Woe to the shepherds who scatter my flock." And the Hebrew there is intensely passionate. God is furious at the false shepherds. He's talking about the kings and the priests and the false prophets of Israel and Judah. They were supposed to teach God's word to God's people, and they had not. And as a result, the people had been led astray into unbelief and idolatry. So God punished them. He drove them away into captivity. He had prophesied that this would be so through Moses in the book of Deuteronomy before they went into the promised land. This is Moses' farewell sermon. He says, you guys are going to go into this promised land and you're going to turn away from the Lord in your hearts. You're going to worship false gods. And God is going to punish you. He's going to send you away into captivity. He's going to scatter you among the nations. So you might say, well, God's the one that did this. Why is he blaming the false teachers? Notice, the reason that God had to punish them in this way was because of the false shepherds. He says to them, you have not visited my sheep. You have not attended to them. You have not cared for them. So I am going to attend to you for the evil of your deeds. So what was it that made them false shepherds? Jeremiah 10:21. For the shepherds are stupid and do not inquire of the Lord. Therefore they have not prospered and all their flock is scattered. Your parents probably teach your kids not to call people stupid, and that's good. But God calls false teachers stupid. He's saying, you had one thing to do. You guys ever said that to somebody? You just had one thing you were supposed to do. And it isn't really that complicated, God says. You were supposed to teach them my word. And when you wanted to know what my word was, you come in and you ask me, God, what do I say to them? God says, here you go, tell them this. And that's it. And they hadn't done it. That was why they had been scattered. They had not taught the law to God's people. They had not taught them to walk in his ways. They had not bound up the wounds of the suffering, of the guilty, of the sick, with the promises of God's gospel in Jesus Christ. And it's the same today. The church is scattered. We sang in the hymn that the world sees the church by schisms rent asunder, by heresies distressed. I know some people at times have taken exception to this hymn. They feel like it's teaching false doctrine, but they're not understanding it correctly. They think that it's saying that the Holy Christian Church is divided. And they're like, well, that's not right, because the Holy Christian Church is all believers through all time and in all places, and they're one in Christ. And that's true, but that's not the point that the hymn writer is making. He's saying that in an outward sense, in this world, it is divided. And it is distressed by the heresies and the schisms that rend it asunder. You could go back. In the early church, they were all one. And then the false doctrine started popping up. And they got together at the Council of Nicaea to condemn the heresy of Arianism. Many were cast out of the church because of that, but they weren't in the church to begin with. Because you believe that Jesus isn't true God, you're not in the church. Then there was the split, the schism, the great schism it's called, between the Eastern and the Western church, now known now as the Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church. And then there are the schisms that have taken place since, and so many. And what you find today is that there are thousands of Christian denominations. And we believe that in every church where the primary fundamental doctrines are taught, that is that Jesus Christ is true God and true man, that his death was the sacrifice to pay for sins, that man is sinful, that there are Christians there. But they're divided from each other. So some people say, well, you know, we've got all these divisions. We just need to agree to disagree. They say, look, the problem is doctrine. You guys keep talking about doctrine, and then there's disagreements, and then we have these splits. That's stupid. They say, well, you just agree to disagree. That's stupid. That's what God says. Because the problem is not doctrine. The problem is false doctrine. This would be kind of like if, you know, if you came up to me and you shot me, and then I said, take me to the hospital. And then you were like, oh no, why do we want to do that? You know? That'll just divide us. And I'm like, the problem, they're like, just leave the bullet in there. It'll make things worse if we take it out. And I say, no, you gotta take the bullet out or I'm gonna die. That's silly. So with false doctrine, the reason for the divisions in the church is not insistence on true doctrine, it's the false doctrine. That's what God's saying. And God has something to say to the false teachers. Woe to you. I am going to attend to you for the evil of your deeds. This should be both frightening and wonderfully comforting to us, to see God as a mama bear protecting his cubs. First, as a warning, because each of us are called in our own ways to inquire of the Lord and teach his word to his people. I, as a pastor for the flock of God that he's called me to serve here, the elders of this congregation, in the same way, called to watch out for the flock, to make sure that the word is being taught correctly. Each of you Christians in your lives, to those people that God has placed in your lives, and especially you parents for your children, God has given them to you to bring up in the training and instruction of the Lord. They're his lambs. He expects to get them back from you. This is always priority number one. There's never anything going on in your life and in their life that even comes close to this. You don't want to get in the way of God and his lambs. And this doesn't consist simply of, well, I've never told them any false doctrine. See, he also said the prophets don't inquire of the Lord. This involves teaching them, not just not teaching them what is wrong, but teaching them what is true. Paul, when he came to the Ephesian elders in Acts 20, he was saying goodbye to them. And he said to them, my conscience is free in connection with you guys because I have not shunned from declaring to you the whole counsel of God, all the teachings of God he had laid before them and fed them as a shepherd feeds his sheep with all good things. That's what each of us is called to do. And yet how often don't we fail? Fail maybe because we're lazy. I don't have time for that today. Fail maybe because we want to spend our time on our passions or pleasures instead of having devotion or coming to church. Fail because we fail to structure our lives. You know, sometimes people say, well, you know, I'm just too busy. It never works out to have devotion. Or I'm just too busy. Can't always make it to church. But that's because we structured our lives that way. We didn't have to. It's a warning. And yet it's also very comforting because Christ looks at us as sheep with all of our weaknesses, with all of our sins, with all of our failures to do this, and he smiles at us. And his heart melts with compassion, as in our gospel reading. He had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. And Jesus himself comes to care for us. See, his anger at the false shepherds is because of his intense, compassionate love for the sheep, for you and for me. So much so that he gave his life on the cross as the Lamb of God to die for your sins. The shepherd died for sheep that love to wander. He laid down his life to lift yours up from the grave. He gave it all to give you all. He bore all sin to set you free from sin's burden. Even his judgment on the false prophets is good news to you. He says to them, you did not attend to my sheep, so I'm going to attend to you. I'm going to take care of you, and then I am going to attend to my sheep. His words are a little bit like, you know, one of those one-liners from some, like, revenge movie, like Taken with Liam Neeson. He says to the people who kidnapped his daughter, I have a very particular set of skills. I will find you, and I will kill you. It's a good line, and we like to hear that because it's this passionate vengeance, right, that's for his daughter against these evil people. And that's what God is saying. Only here, the thing is that God has a far more particular set of skills than Liam Neeson. And so he comes himself to care for you personally. Because, you know, if you want something done right, you got to do it yourself. And that's what God did. He looked down and at these shepherds who were leading these people astray, and he says, I am going to come and care for them myself. So our text says in verse 5, I will raise up for David a righteous branch. This is referring to the prophecy, the promise that God made to David. He said David wanted to build a temple for God, and God says, you're not going to build me a house, I'm going to build you a house. And after you die, I'm going to establish your throne. I'm going to put your son, which will come from your body, on your throne, and he will reign forever. And so you're reading along in this promise, and at first you're thinking, oh, he's talking about Solomon. And he is, in part. But then you read where it says, and he will reign forever. And you're like, that's not Solomon. But he says, your son, who will come from your body. Now, at the time of Jesus, it's been like 500 years since there's been a son of David reigning in Israel or Judah. It seems like God's promise is void. It seems like the stump is cut off. And then in Jesus, Mary's son, born of David's line in David's city, behold, a branch is growing. A shoot from Jesse's stump, born of the line of David according to the flesh. See, what he's saying here, Jeremiah is saying, is that Jesus, the Messiah, will be born from the line of David. That is, he's going to be a human. He's going to be a true man. But then he also says, this is the name which he will be called, the Lord, our righteousness. And the word Lord there is Jehovah. So it's saying that this one whom God promised would come in David's line, this true man would be Jesus, and that he himself would also be the one who made the promise to David in the first place. True God and true man. Talk about a very particular set of skills. He became man in order to care for you personally. So he says, I will gather them out of all the countries where I have driven them. You will find each one. As in the parable of the lost sheep, carrying you home on his shoulders, rejoicing. Now, this promise refers first of all to God bringing the people of Judah back from captivity. He drove them away, and he will bring them back. And he'll bring them back in order to bring Jesus from them. But it refers to more than that. In our text, in our gospel reading, Jesus saw that they were like sheep without a shepherd. They were scattered, and he went to bring them back. And Jesus often talked about how he must come first to the lost sheep of the house of Israel and then to the Gentiles. And all of them would be one flock with one shepherd. This is the true church. That's what Paul was writing about in Ephesians. The church of God, the people of God, is not Israel according to the flesh, but Israel according to faith. From every tribe and nation and tongue and race and people and language. One in Jesus Christ. In our gospel reading, when he was so filled with compassion that despite being tired, I mean, he was trying to get away, right? He was trying to get some rest and relaxation for him, his disciples. They didn't even have time to eat. He spent the whole day teaching and then the evening feeding them because he cared for them personally. And you see this personal care also in the name which Jeremiah gives him. This is the name by which he will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. Now, there are two very personal things here. The first is not so obvious as the second. First, it literally says in Hebrew, this is the name which will be called him, meaning that people will call him this, meaning that you will know him by name and call him by name. You won't have to say, hey guy, or oh God, but Jesus and Emmanuel and the Lord is our righteousness, because he will know you by name. Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. Secondly, it's this phrase itself, the Lord, our righteousness. It doesn't get much more personal than that. Now, as Jeremiah's making a bit of a pun here. Rachel doesn't like my puns, but we should all like this pun. It's more of a play on words. The king of Judah at this time was called Zedekiah. He's a descendant of David. And Zedekiah is from two Hebrew words, Tzedek Yah, from Jehovah. Tzedek Yahweh, meaning the Lord, my righteousness. So Jeremiah says, this other son of David, this branch for David, this true king, he won't just be Tzedek Kayah. He will be Tzedekayenu. It just changes the suffix on the end, and it means the Lord, our righteousness. He will be the righteousness for all of us. He is ours, and you are his. His righteousness is given to you by faith. It is as if you were caught out in a cold, driving rain, chilled to the bone. And then someone came along, and they gave you their wool fleece coat and their rainproof parka, and themselves bore the cold, exposed. So Christ came and found you in the cold, driving, dark rain of your own guilt and sin, which you brought on yourself, and he covered you with those perfect garments which he wove together with a perfect life of righteousness, of warmth and love. And he himself went exposed, cold on the cross. Paul says he became sin in your place so that you might be the righteousness of God in him. His righteousness is yours. He is yours. He covers you completely. Verse 5, it says, he shall establish justice and righteousness in the land. You know, that's the work of a king, to establish just and fair laws for all his subjects and to execute them with justice and righteousness. Problem is that human rulers never do that. Not perfectly. Most of them, far from perfectly. Jeremiah is saying here that this is what Jesus will do. His kingdom will consist of him establishing a new order of righteousness, of justice. And it won't be, okay, guys, here's some new laws. Or, okay, guys, here are the laws of Moses, and here's how you keep them. And it won't be, hey, look, here's how I kept them, and that means you can keep them too. No, it will be, I kept them for you. By faith in me, you are righteous. I am your justice. I am your life. I am your everything. And this brings peace. Notice how our text emphasizes this. Israel, in his days, Israel shall be saved, and Judah shall rest securely. That's talking about you. Not the physical nation of Israel or Judah, but the church of God. They shall not be dismayed, he says. They shall fear no more. That's the effect that the Lord is our righteousness has. You know, people, every church, every religion preaches righteousness somehow. All the religions of the world, Hinduism, Buddhism, all the false religions, all of them teach work righteousness. Islam. This is how you be good enough for God. Follow these laws. And unfortunately, many Christian denominations include a part of that in their teaching as well. Some of them blatantly, some of them not so blatantly. Whenever they focus the Christian's life on what the Christian has to do, it doesn't lead to peace and rest and security. It leads to despair, to wondering, have I been good enough? Have I done enough? Have I lived up to God's commands? Have I chosen him? Am I really one of his sheep? And that constant looking inward distresses us. But when Christ is preached, when the Lord is your righteousness, then you lie down in green pastures and drink from still waters. And even in the valley of the shadow of death, you fear no evil. And in the presence of your enemies, he sets up a table before you and feeds you with his righteousness and the forgiveness of sins. When Christ is everything and Christ has done everything, then there is full peace and security. Other churches these days are obsessed with civil righteousness and with justice for the oppressed. And there are certainly many people in this world who are oppressed, many people who do not find justice. And I'm not saying we shouldn't care about those things. But if you go into one of the mainline Protestant denominations today, like the ELCA or the United Methodist Church, you're likely to hear a sermon about how so-and-so is having a bad time, this group or that group is oppressed, and how it's up to us to help them. But if that's the focus, it just turns the Christian religion into a religion of works again. Because then the focus is on how we can bring justice and righteousness on the earth. And that's an insurmountable task, for one thing. And secondly, then what happens is this. We become obsessed with it. We find our identity in that. And then we view ourselves as righteous and the others as unrighteous. There's no peace there. But only in the righteousness of Christ. That is the kingdom of God, where the righteousness of Christ given to you freely and the forgiveness of sins is proclaimed. There is the church, for there is the true shepherd, the true king. See, what Jeremiah foretells here is pictured perfectly in our gospel reading, where Jesus gets off the boat, sees the sheep, and loves them, teaches them, feeds them, stands in the midst of them. It says that he causes them to sit down in groups on the green grass. You know why it bothers to say the green grass? To remind us of Psalm 23. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. And even though it says they're in a desolate place, it's not desolate when Jesus is there. There it's a picturesque pastoral scene, a picnic in the park. Wherever you are and whatever is happening, because Jesus, your God, is intensely, passionately caring about his sheep, protective of his sheep, and he cares for them and feeds you personally, both in body and in soul. He feeds you with daily bread, often far more daily bread than you need. And as long as he wants you here in this life, he provides for your needs of the body, because he has redeemed you, body and soul. He teaches you his word, sending true shepherds to preach it faithfully. And because, when he wants to take you out of this life, because of his death and resurrection, he then will feed you at the eternal banquet feast of heaven. For it says, he will lead them beside springs of living water, and they shall hunger no more, nor thirst any more. Where you will dwell in the courts of the Lord forever. Because God is passionately protective of his sheep. And God himself.